We want to warmly welcome you for our midweek service that is being held here at ACK St. Mary's Kabete. You are all welcome. Please tell a friend to tell a friend to tap into our YouTube and Facebook channels so that we can fellowship together. Let us begin with a word of prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we commit this service into your hands. We pray for those who are watching online. We pray for the ministry, Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, that is going to come through. For our worship leaders, all those who are on the instruments, we commit them into your hands. We also pray for the ministry of the word. Dear God, we commit this into your able hands, to the glory of your holy name. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Come on, baby. kingdom in this place. We worship you, Lord, and we praise your holy name. We thank you, Lord, that you have created an altar that we may dwell in the midst of your presence. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We want to once more welcome you to our midweek service this Wednesday, and we want to immediately go into the ministry of the word. We are at ACK St. Mary's under the able leadership of our vicar, Reverend Samuel Chege, who has given me this opportunity to minister here, which I do not take for granted. So let us go immediately into the ministry of the word. Today, our sermon is titled Mystery of Altars. Mystery of Altars. And if you recall our vicar on Sunday, he has been talking about keeping the fire burning. And basically, where you keep the fire burning, it is at the altars. So it seems that the Holy Spirit is leading us through a journey, and all we can do is follow him. Let me define what an altar is. This is my simple definition of an altar. An altar is a corporate or individual meeting place between man and God. A corporate or individual meeting place between man and God. It is a place where offerings, sacrifices, prayers, and petitions are regularly made. One has few. It can be a physical place like a church, a retreat center, a room in your house, a tree, or a forest, or a class. Anything, any of those ones. It can also be an online place. For example, a Zoom meeting or an online church service like the one we are having, or an online Bible study. It is also your body, which is the temple of the Holy Spirit. These are all altars. Now, what is it about altars that are very important? As I was in prayer and meditation, the Spirit of God opened my eyes to reveal certain mysteries that we need to be aware of so that we may be more effective in our Christian walk. Number one, let us go to the key text, Genesis chapter 12 from verse 6 to 8. Genesis chapter 12 from verse 6 to 8. This is what the Bible says. Abraham traveled through the land as far as the site of the great tree of Moreh at Shechem. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. The Lord appeared to Abraham and said, "To your offspring I will give this land." So he built an altar there to the Lord, who appeared to him. From there he went on towards the hills east of Bethel and pitched his tent, with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. There he built an altar to the Lord and called upon the name of the Lord. I believe that that is the first time an altar was raised in the Bible. There might be others, I may be wrong, but I believe that was the first time. Now, what is it that God was speaking to me about altars? Now, first thing, the first point I want to make is an altar is a mark or a marker of territory. That is what an altar is. It is a marker of territory. Hallelujah. Now, listen to me. There is great importance of an altar to the Lord. It marks out territories of God and for God. Let me explain it more. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob traveled through all Canaan, raising altars in those territories that they traveled, so that one day, 500 years later, Israel would own that land. Are you hearing what I'm saying? They owned that land. After Joshua conquered the territory of Israel, that land belonged to Israel. In Joshua's time, Israel conquered and owned the whole territory of Canaan. Similarly, a family must raise an altar in the house they live in, so that a territory is marked out for the Lord. A territory. This is a marker. It is a marker. When you are, a territory is demarcated by, what are those things called? Fence, isn't it? There is a fence, isn't it? When you raise an altar somewhere, a fence, the Lord begins to raise an altar there. Hallelujah. This is the thing. If you remember the story of Job, altars were around him. He used to sacrifice offerings and tithes there during his time there. And then what happened? A hedge of fire surrounded him. Hallelujah. A hedge of fire surrounded him so that Satan was unable to penetrate. When Satan went to God and God asked, have you considered my servant Job? What did Satan say? Hey, there is a hedge of fire. I cannot be able to penetrate it. You know what I'm saying? When you raise an altar, especially when you are a family, do it when the mother is there, the child is there. All of you together, pray together in that place. Raise an altar where you regularly meet. And what is going to happen is God is going to send two things. He's going to mark out that territory. That is a Christian territory. My people live there. He's going to put a hedge of fire, unless the Bible is lying. Hello? He's going to put a hedge of fire so that you cannot be able to penetrate it. Listen. In 1989, when my father was working as an archbishop, thugs sent by politicians were sent to our house to kill him, my father did, to kill him. What they did is they raised over 50, because when this whole thing was over, and a report was made, the report was given to my father and he read it to us. So we know who was involved. Are you hearing what I'm saying? So, they came, they wanted to take my father, put him in his car, and then throw him in Nyamindi River so that he dies. That was the plan. So that now he stops disturbing the politicians there in Kirinyaga. Now, what happened that day is there were two bishops there. There was my father and there was another bishop, Andrew Adame. Andrew was a Somali kind of a guy. So he was throwing stones to those thieves. But you see, God had protected us. We were about six people in that house. And we were being surrounded by how many people? 50. 50. They broke the doors and entered. They actually broke it. But somehow, before they wanted to do what they did, the people all around that area knew something was happening and they started coming. So that the people ran away. No one was caught, no one was hurt. I believe, and that time I was not born again, that God had put us a hedge around us. One of the things about, are you getting what I'm saying? So one of the things about an altar is that it is a marker of territory. Only with God's permission will Satan be able to penetrate Job's, our territory. Like for example, in Job's case. But only for a season. And Job's latter position was twice better than his former position, isn't it? He got double for his trouble. A regular raised altar will demark territory that the enemy will find impenetrable. I need to tell you that. It is important for families to raise altars. There ought to be full participation in that altar. One of the problems we are having is that the enemy is finding ways. Even when we're watching this online service, ought to try and do it as a family. So that the territory that the enemy seeks to penetrate, even the church, members of that church, who now we are demarcating territory of members, when we decree and declare things here, you are participating in it. I want to declare one thing. Can I declare one thing? Hii maneno ya corona. Unless God wills it, you are all protected. Hallelujah. Amen. Can I hear your amen?
Amen.
You see, we make declarations at an altar. So it's good to stop that altar so that God hears the word that has spoken on that altar and begins to send his angels to protect it. Are you hearing what I'm saying? So number two, an altar, this is another mystery, is a gateway to open heavens. This one, when God was revealing it to me, I was saying, what are you talking about? Let us go to Genesis chapter 28. Genesis 28 from 10 to 15. Jacob left Beersheba and set out for Haran. When he reached a certain place, he stopped for the night. The sun had set. Taking one of the stones there, he put it under his head and lay down to sleep. He had a dream, which he saw a staircase resting on the earth, a stairway, with the top reaching to heaven. Angels were ascending and descending. There above stood the Lord, and he said, I am the Lord of your father Abraham and the God of Isaac. I will give your descendants the land in which you are lying. Hallelujah. Later, I don't want to read all of it, when Job woke up, he confessed, this is indeed the house of God, the gate, hallelujah, the gate of heaven. Remember that Abraham had already raised an altar in this region, isn't it? Because that place is called Bethel, house of God. The word Bethel is house of God. This place is called Bethel. Genesis chapter 12, verse 8. So the territory had already been marked out. Now Jacob did not pray. Did he pray? He just slept, isn't it? Did he pray? No, he didn't. Did he seek God? No. He only laid down to rest, and immediately the gates of heaven opened for him. When you raise altar and regularly service that altar, regularly bring prayer and all the things the vicar was saying, that altar begins to speak back to you, open heavens. Huh. In contrast, let us look at someone else. Daniel had to fast for how many days? See, 21 days, isn't it? For there was warfare in heaven for the breakthrough to come. Gabriel told Daniel, if you go to Daniel chapter 10, go and check there. As soon as you began to pray and seek understanding, your words were heard and I was sent. Immediately he began to pray. But I was withheld by the prince of Persia 21 days. Look at the contrast. One, he only sleeps. Then the heavens open. The other one, he has to pursue it in prayer. Are you getting now? Are you trying to see? In Babylon, you see, let me just give you the context of this. In Babylon, there were many altars to satanic gods, those Babylonian gods. The gods of Babylon were making it difficult for breakthroughs to come to the children of Israel. Because of the gods, the altars which were there, they were interfering with the connection with heaven. Similarly, in this nation and country, there are many satanic altars that are making breakthroughs difficult. Ancient traditional altars, like the Kayas among the Mijikenda. How many of you have know about them? Kayas among Mijikenda. You know, but you know about the Kayas of the Mijikenda, isn't it? There are about 50 Kaya altars there in Mombasa. There is this shrine in Nyeri called Mukuru wa Wakikuyu, Wanyagadanga. Where unaijua? It's called Mukuru Wanyagadanga. And people go there to bless leaders, and all manner of things happen there. And you hear what I'm saying? That is a difficult. Then there is Jorinjeke. Nobody here is from Meru, so leave that. Then there are Masonic temples. There is a Masonic temple opposite All Saints Cathedral. Go and read what happens. Masonic altars and temples is satanic. Very terrible. And they are here in our nation. Okay? It is their opposite All Saints. Then there are Buddhist temples and Hindu shrines in this nation, and so on and so forth. Okay? Now, you see, now that's why, so that God's kingdom may reign here, we need to raise altars where we are. When altars to the God of heaven are raised and sacrifices regularly placed on them, we fight these altars of the enemy. If it was possible to destroy them, we could do it. But you know, now here in Kenya, we have what is called freedom of what? Freedom of religion. You can have any religion you want, isn't it? Yeah. This is a very big problem. Actually, let me tell you something. I didn't like it when the president brought very many other people to praise him. On that day, we had the National Day of Prayer. It was mixing things. The Bible says that you shall have no other God before me, isn't it? Now, do you know what those... Now, this is what the Spirit was speaking in my mind. Do you know what those angels were doing as they were ascending and they were descending? Eh? The Bible is interesting. They were being sent by God to bring blessings, mercy. Because God is a God of mercy, isn't it? To bring healing. Because by His stripes we are healed, isn't it? To bring deliverance, to bring promotion, to bring provision, to bring protection and direction. That is why God spoke to Jacob and told him, I am the Lord your God who brought your fathers, who have got a covenant. He had a covenant with him. That's what an altar primarily does. Now remember this. Remember this, please. I'm trying to explain it. Moses commanded Israel, when they inherited the territory, to do this. Go to Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 5. They were to break down their altars of the people of Canaan. Break down their altars, smash their sacred stones, cut down their Asherah poles, and burn their idols in the fire. Why were they supposed to do that? So that those altars don't speak to them. Are you hearing what I'm saying? See, we must raise altars of influence within our sphere. Wherever you are, where do you work, Dan? Where do you work? Yeah. Hapo kule kwa self-employed. Raise an altar there. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Raise an altar there so that it interferes with other altars around there. Is there anybody here who works with an Indian? If there is an Indian who is worshipping those three million gods, raise an altar there. Otherwise, you are going to be in trouble. You will always be broke. Because they know what they do. They take that money which they give you and they do rituals on it so that you become very broke. Hallelujah. So we must raise altars of influence. Okay? Finally, Daniel and his three friends convinced Nebuchadnezzar by their faithfulness to God to raise an altar to the God of heaven in Babylon. May we do the same. Number three, mystery. An altar is a place of sacrifice. An altar is a what? Now this is a mystery. Sacrifice is the currency of heaven. Let us go to 1 Kings chapter 3 from verse 4 to 5. The king, that is Solomon, went to Gibeon to offer sacrifices. For that was the most important high place, and Solomon offered 1,000 burnt offerings on that altar. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon during the night in a dream, and God said, ask for me for whatever you want. Let me ask you, Ian, if God asks you for whatever you want, what would you answer? A lot. What would you answer? Satisfaction and contentment. Satisfaction and contentment. Imagine, because of all the sacrifices he was making, God simply told him, ask for whatever you want. This offering or this sacrifice triggered what I call blank check anointing. Just you are given a blank check by God. Let me explain something to you. The system of Babylon operates on a monetary exchange system. Okay, capitalist system. Anybody know what I mean by capitalism? Capitalism is grab, amass as much as you can. Amass as much as you can, not caring for your fellow brother. Is that what is happening here in Kenya? Amass as much as you can. The kingdom system is a giving system. It operates on the levers of sacrificial giving. This thing is opposed everywhere. Let us go to Luke chapter 6, verse 38. It says, give, and you shall receive how many measures? A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. Listen, giving comes back with four blessings. Whatever you give. Now, giving to the Lord, of course, even to the orphan, the widow, the alien, the sick person, the prisoner. Giving is a kingdom principle. Giving to the needy person, whether in kind or in cash, or even transfer of knowledge, whichever way you can give, give. That is the currency of heaven. Let me tell you something. Ooh. Givers never lack. Take that to the bank. Let me repeat. Givers, I'm not telling you to give to only to the church. Givers, for even charity, unamwona huyu manu chandani. Is he a Christian? Is he a Christian? He has given, isn't it? They never lack. The giving to the Lord, listen, they never lack. Okay? In contrast, we have grabbers. You have one side, they are givers, and another side, they are land grabbers, title deed grabbers, property grabbers, thieves, and so on and so forth. Cut your hair on it. And you know, us guys, let me tell you, we have deified grabbers. Am I talking to myself? Mumenyamaza, ni sawa tu. Si grabbers are considered superstars. Ama namna gani? Eh? Si they are superstars. Land grabbers are superstars. They are in parliament. We have elected them. I am in the jongelesha. That is why, let me tell you, grabbers end badly. The kingdom system is give. The world system is grab. Hallelujah. Cornelius was a Gentile. That means he hata hakukuwa anajua ni nini mambo ya Mungu. He was visited in a dream and told this by God. Your prayers and gifts to the poor have come up to me as a memorial offering. That is God. Acts chapter 4, go and read chapter 10, go and read from verse 4 to the end. Finally, in that story, Peter went to Cornelius to teach him the ways of salvation as a reward for his gifts. Immediately, him and his whole family and all those ones who were under his care were born again and filled with the Holy Spirit and power. That was a gift God gave him. Because of his giving and his gifts to the poor and his prayers. So keep servicing the altar of God with sacrificial giving. For this is the sure economy of the kingdom. Let me tell you, and I don't practice this. Let me tell you something. And it's not good kuyumba yumba na kuambia watu zile vitu mimi ufanya. Since ni sawa. Wewe jua tu, Mungu, I've practiced this. I'm just practicing in our naiki to in our work. And sometimes God is going to tell you to do something. And he has told me several times, I want you to do something for so and so. And so at that time you are in trouble, you are really broke. Hello? Am I talking to myself? And so, because the Spirit of God has moved me to do it, I do it with joy. Of course, Salimina in a resist because of the grabbing culture I've been brought up in. Are you getting what I'm saying? Let us be honest, it is not easy sometimes to break away from it. But once you lay it there before God and do it with a joyful heart, it comes back to you, good measure. This is a mystery, and it is not something that people do unless it comes to them as a revelation. Are you hearing what I'm saying? It is a revelation. You really want to understand it? Go and see everywhere, even God himself gave his son. For God gave his only begotten son that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. Now, he has many sons. The fourth mystery, an altar, is a place of covenant. An altar is a place that God makes promises, makes covenants. Abraham was promised at Mount Moriah. What did he do? He went there with his son. He sacrificed, he was supposed to sacrifice. Go and bring your son, your only son, whom you love. Eh? He was told, let me ask, Maggie, anaitwa Asha, if God told you to do that, what would you do? Eh? Unasema nini, unataka kumenyamaza, isn't it? God told Abraham, I wonder whether it's a difficult thing. He told him, bring your son, your only son whom you love. He brought him up the mountain. He placed him there. He took the knife as he was about to kill him. Plop, mutu ikatokea, kitu ikatokea. He said, stop. And this is the promise that was made at that point. I swear by my name, because of what you have done. This is the first time in scripture that God has been known to swear by his name. The first time. I swear by my name. And he was told, your descendants will possess the gates of your enemies. Genesis chapter 22, go and read verse 50 to 18. And other promises. David was promised that his name would be great. That's a promise, a covenant. That he would rest from his enemies. That is a covenant. That his offspring would reign in his place. That is a covenant. Solomon was promised wisdom, riches, and honor. These covenants were made at altars that were regularly serviced. For some of us, there is a covenant of protection. Here, I believe there is a covenant of protection. For some, there is a covenant of increase. If you want this covenant, I want to hear your amen. Covenant of increase. Covenant of protection. Covenant of wisdom in certain areas. Covenants, what else? Covenant of joy. Hallelujah. Regularly service the altar that you have been raised, that you have raised, and submit to it. So there are four mysteries there, and actually you can even go through them in the mighty name of Jesus. So let us pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, may we be found regularly servicing the altars that the Lord has directed us to in the matchless name of Jesus. Give us the heart to do it, to demarcate territory, to get open heavens. Oh God, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, so that you may minister with us. May those who are under the anointing here get the revelation of the mystery of altars, that their territories, their houses, their workplace stations, their workplaces are demarcated as territories belonging to God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you desire to worship God with your offerings and tithes and thanksgivings, you're welcome to give to our Safaricom number 991740. You're also welcome to give you have a check to give it to ACK St. Mark's Church. ACK St. Mary's Parish Church. ACK St. Mary's Parish Church. And the Lord will bless you. We want to ask that we pray for the offerings as they are given. Dear Heavenly Father, bless the hands that give to the work of God and to other charity works. Bless their health, bless the works, bless their children, bless the animals in their farms, bless their homes, bless their spouses, bless their relationships. In Jesus' matchless name. And everybody said,